Hello and welcome to worship with the community at First Congregational Church of Boulder, United Church of Christ, on this, the second Sunday of Lent and the last Sunday of Black History Month. Whenever and wherever you find yourself with us, we welcome you. First Congregational Church is a welcoming and inviting community where we strive to put into practice the calling of beloved community. And one of the things that's said in our denomination is that Jesus didn't reject anyone, so neither do we. But we realize that not rejecting is just a first step. Acceptance is the next step. And after that comes engagement. And it's through engagement that we become part of one another's stories. And so when we become part of one another's stories, we become invested in the outcome of the story built on our mutuality. So we welcome you to this moment where our stories converge with God's grand redemptive love story. Sisters and brothers and friends, we've been called to this moment for love's purposes. So let us open our hearts to love's word for us today. And may the peace of Christ be with you.
Join me in prayer. Creator of life, when we ignore the value of any neighbor's life, whether it is the person upon whom we project our fears or the creatures of the wild and the earth that sustains us all, we lose sight of the whole story of creation, and consequently, we lose sight of ourselves. So in this hour, God, we pray. Open unto me light for my darkness. Open unto me courage for my fear. Open unto me hope for my despair. Open unto me peace for my turmoil. Open unto me joy for my sorrow. Open unto me strength for my weakness. Open unto me wisdom for my confusion. Open unto me forgiveness for for my sins. Open unto me tenderness for my toughness. Open unto me love for my hates. Open unto me thyself for myself. Lord, Lord, open unto me. For as we allow ourselves this opening to happen, we become the gift you have called us to be. Let it be so. Amen.
Our scripture passage this morning comes from the Hebrew Bible, Isaiah chapter 53:1-9. For those of you who have heard this before, you may have been taught that this scripture passage is a story or a passage that anticipates the coming Messiah. And so I invite you to listen to this story, both with new ears and with the ears that you've maybe heard it with before, and to see if anything new emerges. Isaiah 53:1-9. Who has believed our message? And to whom has the Lord been revealed? He grew up before him like a tender shoot and like a root out of dry ground. He had no beauty or majesty to attract us to him, nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by humankind, a man of suffering and familiar with pain. Like one from whom people hide their faces, he was despised and we held him in low esteem. Surely, he took up our pain and bore our suffering, yet we considered him punished by God, stricken by God, afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was on him. And by his wounds, we are healed. We all, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned to our own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. He was led like a lamb to the slaughter. And as sheep before its shearers is silent, so he did not open his mouth. By oppression and judgment he was taken away. Yet who of his generation protested? For he was cut off from the land of the living. For the transgression of my people he was punished. He was assigned a grave with the wicked and with the rich in his death, though he had done no violence, nor was there any deceit in his mouth. Words that transcend time. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Holy One, who is holy one, be in our hearts and minds this day as we seek to find our place in your love story. Amen. So I want to begin our time together by reading portions of letters written between a free black man and a white freedom-loving patriot concerning the American Bill of Rights that was adopted in 1791. Hear first the words from the free black man. I suppose it's a truth too well attested to you to need proof here, that we are a race of beings who have long labored under the abuse and censure of the world, that we have long been looked upon with an eye of contempt, and that we have long been considered rather as brutish than human, and scarcely capable of mental endowments. Sir, I hope that I may safely admit, in consequence of that report which hath reached me, that you are a man far less inflexible in sentiments of this nature than many others, that you are measurably friendly and well disposed toward us, and that you are willing and ready to lend your aid and assistance to our relief from those many distresses and numerous calamities to which we are reduced. Now, sir, if this is founded in truth, I apprehend you will readily embrace every opportunity to eradicate that train of absurd and false ideas and opinions which so generally prevails with respect to us, and that your sentiments are concurrent with mine, which are that one universal Father or Creator hath given being to us all, and that he hath not only made us all of one flesh, but that he, the Creator, hath also, without partiality, afforded us all the same sensations and endued us all with the same faculties, and that however variable we may be in society or religion, however diversified in situation or color, we are all of the same family and stand in the same relation to our Creator. Now, in response to this letter, the other person wrote, "Sir, I thank you sincerely for your letter of the 19th, instant for the almanac it contained. Nobody wishes more than I do to see such proofs as you exhibit, that nature has given to our black brethren talents equal to those of other colors of men, and that the appearance of a want in of them is owing merely to the degraded condition of their existence in both in Africa and America. I can add with truth that nobody wishes more ardently to see a good system commenced for raising the condition both of their body and mind to what it ought to be, as fast as the imbecility of their present existence and other circumstance, which cannot be neglected, will admit. I have taken the liberty of sending your almanac to Monsieur de Condorcet, Secretary of the Academy of Sciences at Paris and member of the Philanthropic Society, because I considered it as a document to which your whole color had a right for their justification against the doubts which have been entertained of them. I am, with great esteem, sir, your most obedient and humble servant. Now, when you hear that second letter in response to the free black man, one might assume that the person who responded to that letter may be some sort of abolitionist or some person who outwardly showed concern for the plight of black people in America and chose to use their abilities and their networking and their power in their circumstance to assist their brothers and sisters. But you'd be mistaken, because the person who wrote that letter was, for our history buffs who may already know this, was our second president and inspiration of the Bill of Rights, Thomas Jefferson. And the person with whom he was corresponding was Benjamin Banneker, a free black man who was well known for his almanacs and his works surveying the original borders of Washington, D.C. And there's more to Banneker's story should you decide to explore it. But I want to acknowledge the fact that President Jefferson was able to acknowledge in his letter that nature has given to our black brethren talents equal to those of the other colors of men, and that the appearance of a want of them is owing merely to the degraded condition of their existence, both in Africa and America. But the fact that he did nothing to back his words might lead one to believe that he was simply patronizing Mr. Banneker, especially considering that nearly 230 years later, the same appearance of want has been attributed to people who look like Benjamin Banneker. Now, I know that talking about one of the founders of our country in this way may seem like I'm stepping on a sacred cow, and yet, we know that the story of America is a complex and complicated one, and that there are many stories like that of the exchange between Benjamin Banneker and Thomas Jefferson. And yet, when we are given the story, when we are taught the stories of how we are founded in the course of our nation, and many stories of how we found ourselves to be where we are, there's so much of the stories that are left out. And I think that that's because so often we look for easy answers, things that make us feel comfortable, things that make us feel good about ourselves. But have you ever noticed that some people's easy answers are at the expense of other people's hard truths? And it's often that way. For too many of us try to make sense of a complicated world in the simplest way we can come up with, because the part of our brain that is wired for survival is also the part that takes the path of least resistance, the part that is always trying to figure out what box to put things in, the part that wants everything to be as obvious as black and white. But the hard truth about easy answers is they are rarely either. In the long run, they're not easy, and they usually leave us with more questions than answers. Take, for example, when we hear about a tragedy like what happened to Kurt Reinhold, the 42-year-old black man killed by the police last September after a confrontation over jaywalking. Jaywalking. Someone looking for the easy answer will start with the path of least resistance. If the police killed someone, then the person must have done something wrong. Easy math. But then a video comes out. They stopped him for jaywalking. But he questioned them about why and argued with them and tried to walk away. That led to a tussle that resulted in him being shot and killed. Person looking for the easy answer? Well, technically, jaywalking is a crime. And that's one I imagine that no one who sees this has ever committed. So the stop was justified, according to that line of thinking. He should have just complied and then everything would have been all right. The officers were just doing their job. But then another video comes out. And this one is of the officers talking before the stop. One officer tries to discourage the other officer from stopping the man and making something out of nothing, a gesture that could have saved Mr. Reinhold's life and prevented them from being two more officers involved in the death of an unarmed black man had it been successful. But he ended up going along with the jaywalking stop that killed one more of us. Jaywalking. Now, I don't think it matters who's writing the story. No story of jaywalking should end in a death sentence. Being cold and wearing a ski mask, regardless of the weather, should not be a death sentence. Being in a mental health crisis should not end in a death sentence. But it does happen, and it will keep happening until we change the conditions that make this acceptable in our society. Brains looking for easy answers that come at the expense of someone else's hard truths. So, if you find yourself looking for an easy answer, hey, I understand it, I get it. And I don't want the takeaway here to be to blame your brain. The brain is a magnificent creation. And if I were an alien examining humanity from the inside out, I'd go so far as to call the brain a highly advanced biotechnological marvel, a miraculous tool, a magnificent mechanism. But as some people have articulated it, the brain is a brilliant servant, but it is a terrible master. That is to say that the brain can get programmed to see certain patterns. And when we practice a behavior long enough, we can let the brain take over for our conscious awareness so that we can do things like chew gum, tap the top of our head, and rub our bellies at the same time. But when we lose sight of who is doing the programming, the brain can convince us that something that isn't there is. And likewise, it can convince you that something that is there isn't. So we have to challenge our brains. The term blind spotting, if you've never heard of it, was coined in the 2018 film of the same name, written by and starring David Diggs of Hamilton fame. In the film, his character, Colin's ex-girlfriend Val, comes up with this term, blind spotting, as a mnemonic device to help her remember the awareness conveyed in Rubens' vase, as seen on your bulletin, which demonstrates the limits of perception, i.e. the dualism that we can't see. Val explains to him that when someone looks at the picture, they either see the vase or they see the two faces, but never both at the same time. Once the other image is revealed to us, even though we're able to see it, our brains will still always see the first image we perceived. And it's only after we consciously remind our brains that there's another image there that we are not seeing that the other image will again emerge. And it doesn't matter how many times you remind yourself, you will still see what your brain first told you was there. That means that you have to keep working. So if you saw two faces in the beginning, you'll see two faces and then you'll remember, oh yeah, and there's a vase. If you saw the vase or vase first, then your brain will see that and then you go, and now I see the two faces. That's how our brains work. If we're aware of that, we can do something about it. If we just surrender to it, then we're programmed. Part of the reason that Val tells Colin this is that it functions as a narrative device to give the audience an explanation for why the police tend to see black and brown skin as weapons. Because you see, Colin in this movie is struggling after seeing an unarmed black man shot in the back and killed while fleeing from a police officer, which again doesn't warrant a death sentence. Colin has not reported the incident because he is himself on probation with only three days left on his term. So he has to wrestle with reporting what he's seen and the fact that because he was stuck at a stoplight where he's witnessed this event, he would have been technically late to his halfway house, which would have been a probation violation that could have put him back in jail. If you haven't seen the film Blindspotting, I recommend that you watch it. It's very intense and it will help illuminate some of what I'm saying. Now, there's this adage in Gestalt psychology, the school of thought that supposes that when humans try to make sense of the world, we tend to look at components as being part of a greater whole. That adage is, the whole is greater than the sum of its parts. The whole is greater than the sum of its parts. Now, as a person with a philosophical bent, I can admit that in most cases, I like the idea of something bigger. The idea that there's a greater meaning to everything that happens. And so I probably, as much as the next person, see or at least try to see a bigger picture. The whole is greater than the sum of its parts. But as someone who knows what it's like to have people look at a part of who I am and make up a whole story about me, I realize that while it may be comforting in many instances to look for the higher meaning when it comes to people's stories, it's important to remember that while it can sometimes be accurate to consider that the whole, W-H-O-L-E, is greater than the sum, S-U-M, of its parts, for the sake of engagement and deep and actual authentic encounter, we should consider that it's also sometimes accurate that the whole, H-O-L-E, can be greater than some, S-O-M-E, of its parts. In other words, when something is missing from a story, don't allow your brain to fill it in with whatever or wherever the path of least resistance is. That isn't to say that it might not come up. In some ways, that's just the brain using its programmed efficiencies. But when it does this, remember that the brain is a brilliant servant, but it's a terrible master. Sometimes the greatest form of protest and injustice is against the thoughts in our own brains. But in telling you this, I don't want you to be discouraged. None of us are so special that we're going through anything that no one before us has gone through. That is part of being humanity. In this tradition that we're practicing, one of our own teachers was very forward about his struggles, and we've discussed this before. The way Paul articulated it to the Roman church was, "For I have the desire to do what is good, but I cannot carry it out. For I do not do the good I want to do, but the evil I do not want to do, this I keep on doing. Now, if I do what I do not want to do, it is no longer I who do it, but the sin that's living in me that does it." That is to say, I'm programmed by a bunch of behavior to act against what I know is right. But realizing this, in other letters and other sayings of Paul, he prays for a different mind, the mind of Christ, the mind who can see the whole story and use that awareness to fill in the holes in all of our stories with the reality of God's love story. And as I was looking at this and reading and thinking and contemplating how to articulate what I want to share with you today, I realized that God understands our tendency for that gestalt. I think they call it a gestalt trip or a gestalt click. And I think God, in some winning ways, understands that. And so God uses a story with holes to reveal the whole story in a gestalt kind of way, so that something that you see is there, but then there's also more that you don't see. So we look at this story of Jesus, and we look at the scripture passage that we said earlier alludes to the story of Jesus in Isaiah, and it talks about how the pain that Jesus took on, and I'll read it to you again. It says, surely he took up our pain and bore our suffering. Yet we considered him punished by God, stricken by him and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought peace was on him, and by his wounds we are healed. This person suffered so that we can feel better. Now, I'll venture to say that with or without Jesus, sacrilegious as it may sound, this is a human tendency, that we tend to project and to put our pain on others. And that if we do this, how miraculous is it, how wonderful is it to imagine that God broke into our tendencies and flipped our tendencies upside down. It says, I know you do this. And so because you do this, I'm going to use this very thing that you do to bring a higher awareness. Elsewhere in the scripture, it says that all these things happened and no one protested. I submit to you that in this story, we have an opportunity to protest in our own minds, to protest in our own thoughts, to look at the wisdom that comes from not allowing the innocent to perish because we want to take the easy route and to let that be our healing. No more of this, as we've articulated in other sermons in the past. And so if we can see this and we know the tendency of our brains to look for the easy route, let us then take this story that has holes, literal holes, and allow it to invite us into the whole story so that we can find our place in it. I'm going to tell you one more story, and then I'm going to invite you to listen to a beautiful song from the play Ragtime that articulates more of the story. Before I left my hometown, and some of you may know this, for the second time, I had a dream. And in the dream, I was walking outside with every black man that I'd ever known. And the police showed up. And the police said, we're looking for a black man who stole someone's radio. We asked, who was it? He said, it doesn't matter. We're taking all of you. We were all taken to jail, and they started filling out paperwork to give all of us life sentences. And everyone was protesting, this isn't right, this isn't fair. But as they went one after the other, we started to just give up. And then finally they came to the end of the paper, the forms, and there were no more forms left. And the only one who hadn't filled one out yet was me. And they said to me, well, looks like it's your lucky day. You're free to go. And I said, I'm not going. I don't want to go. If all of us are going to be in prison forever, then I'm going to remain in prison as well. And then my friend said to me, Pedro, get out of here. Leave. If you can get out, get out. But when you do, tell them that we're innocent. Tell them that we're innocent. When we look at these stories, these tragic stories that happen, we look at them and now we're at the place in our consciousness where we go, this shouldn't happen. What a tragedy. But as we talked about in our last conversation, we also set the stage for these types of things to happen. And the only thing that we can do to stop that is to change the setting, to change the stage, and to rewrite and fill in those holes with something grander, something more beautiful. We have this opportunity in our community, in the things that we're learning, the ways that we're engaging, but we can't let easy answers fill in those holes. We have to struggle. We have to make this difficult time, we have to take it into ourselves, and we have to say that we are not gonna take the easy answer, that we're gonna hear the whole story. And that we will not just allow something to be written upon the history of humanity that for hundreds of years has continued to go on. We won't be like our second president who saw the reality but made his choice to continue in his own path. Or unfortunately, the officer in the case of Mr. Reinhold who knew better but didn't do better. Today is the time, now is the time, not simply because people are doing something for other people, but it's for all of us because all of our stories are one. As Benjamin Banneker said, we all come from one creator, and that we are part of one family. And he said to, as he said to our second president, if I found this truth, if this is founded in truth, I apprehend you will readily embrace every opportunity to eradicate that train of absurd and false ideas and opinions which so generally prevails with respect to us, and that your sentiments are concurrent with mine, which are that one universal creator has given being to us all, and that this creator hath not only made us all of one flesh, but that the creator hath with all also with partial without partiality afforded us all the same sensations and endued us all with the same faculties, and that however variable we may be in society or religion, however diversified in situation or color, we are all of the same family and stand in the same relation to our Creator. This is the story that we have the opportunity to share and to be a part of. And I pray that we continue to tell it. Thanks be to God.
Go out and tell our story, let it echo far and wide, make them hear you, make them hear you. How justice was our battle, and how justice was denied, make them hear you.
Will you please pray with me? Truthful and compassionate God, through your love and compassion, you have revealed the whole story to us. It is in you that we have our life and our being. When the world rearranges the story by presenting only partial truths or paradigms that can serve power for only a few, Help us to hear the whole story and to pattern our lives after your son and our brother, Jesus. Help us to be courageous in imagining how we can impact for good the story for all of your creation. Today, compassionate God, we come with concerns for all of your children. We pray for the family of Kurt Reinhold, a black man who in September was shot and killed after jaywalking. We pray protection and equality for all of our black and brown siblings. We pray for the families of over 500,000 people in the United States who have died from COVID and over 2 million more in the world. We pray too for those who have lost loved ones during this pandemic from other causes, but must grieve isolated from family members due to physical distancing. Nurturing and loving God, we pray for parents and others who find themselves raising families and caring for aging parents. In the midst of this honor, we acknowledge it takes special skills. Grant them your unending love and energy as they care for their families, both young and old. God, we pray your presence, peace, and love for Peter and Sue Berkland. For Judy Lambert, fill her heart and mind with comfort and love, and for her family as well, as Judy is in hospice care. We pray for comfort and healing for Elena Burton as she suffers with shingles. We pray for the Yeager family. We praise you that Julie Kamrath's 99-year-old father recovered from COVID but has skin cancer. We praise you that Malaika McCullough's baby is growing. We pray for continued growth as that baby is expected to enter this world in March. We pray too for the Teitelbaum family as they prepare for their new baby in March. We pray for health and well-being for baby and mother. Now, please join as we all pray together, Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. You make me lie down in green pastures and lead me beside still waters. You revive my soul and guide me along right pathways for your name's sake. Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You spread a table before me in the presence of those who trouble me. You have anointed my head with oil, and my cup is running over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen. Thank you.
how good it is to be together as a community of faith at whatever time you are joining us. Thank you for your presence, for your commitment to our life together, and for all of your prayers. If you are a newcomer in our midst, thank you for joining us. If you'd like for us to know that you were here, you can send us a note through our online friendship form. You'll find a link for that form just below your video screen on YouTube. If you send us enough information, we will write you back. If you have a prayer request, you may also use that form to let us know of your concern for yourself, for others, for the world. Pedro and I receive these forms, and we join you in prayer during the week. Today, after worship, we will hold the annual meeting of our congregation. It's the occasion when we gather to look at the year behind and to preview the year ahead. We welcome and confirm new board and ministry members. We thank all those who have served in such capacities for the past year. We look at and vote on our operating budget, which is for us a theological statement of our purposes and priorities. As church people in the tradition of the United Church of Christ, we go to a lot of meetings. We actually believe in them. At their best, they are sacred occasions for us. We meet to talk with one another about things that matter to us and to make decisions about our life together. We meet so that we can rehearse with one another the kind of life and build the kind of community that we hope for the whole world. We meet so that together we can find ways to bring into our bruised and battered world a little more mercy, a little more hope, more healing, more kindness, more justice, more love on behalf of God. Today, our annual meeting will be held on Zoom. In favor of simplicity, we're going to skip our usual coffee hour this week and move right into our annual meeting. You'll find the link for that meeting in your Sunday morning email and in the bulletin. Please note that we've also given you the meeting ID and the passcode in case you happen to come in through a Zoom door that expects information from you to enter that room. Every year on this day, I give thanks for the 14 Colorado pioneers in Valmont Butte who came together to found this congregation in 1864. I love to imagine them now, looking at all of you, at all of us, seeing what has become of us since that first faithful meeting. I hope you will attend today's meeting, all of you, everyone, old-timer, newcomer, member, friend, visitor. We cannot be who we are as a congregation without you. So come to that meeting after this one so that together we can give thanks again for our life with one another, so that we can give thanks for all that God has done for us. Here now, as we prepare for annual meeting, is Libby Black with a message from our stewardship team.
Good morning, church family. I'm Libby, and I'm the chair of stewardship here at the church, and I'm here this morning to say thank you. Your generosity is always amazing. We've had a great stewardship season filled with fun and inspiring words and grace gifts, and you folks have shown God's grace and love over and over again for the church, for our faith, and for one another as we make sure that we can march into the coming year with strength. We have exceeded our goal once again. So if you'd like to hear the details, come to the annual meeting after the service and be glad and celebrate in the generosity that you have shown through God's grace. Thank you all so much.
Lift every voice and sing.
friends, as you go out into this world, sometimes perhaps wondering where you fit into this grand love story of God, I invite you to remember this, that God does not call the perfect, but those who can be perfected. God does not call the worldly wise, but those who can learn. God does not call the fulfilled, but those in whom the Spirit can be poured. God did not call us yesterday. God will not call us tomorrow. God calls us right now. So remember these words of Teresa of Avila. Christ has no body now but ours. No hands, no feet on earth but ours. Ours are the eyes through which Christ looks compassion on this world. Ours are the feet with which Christ walks to do good. Ours are the hands through which Christ blesses all of the world. Ours are the hands. Ours are the feet. Ours are the eyes. We are Christ's body. Christ has no body now on earth but ours. Go in peace. Amen. Thank you.